Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, members. Welcome to this meeting of the Development Management Committee. Peter, do we have any apologies?
Yes, Chairman, there are three from Councillor Brush, Councillor Casey, and Councillor Kay. Councillor Cartwright is standing in for Councillor Kay.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Councillor Cartwright. Announcements, I'll keep them mercifully short. In the event, you probably know better than I, because you're probably more familiar with this building, but in the event of an emergency, there's a fire exit there, there's a fire exit here, and we're required to muster in the first instance in the car park, over in the western corner, where there's a little green sign on top of a pole. Failing which, I'm open to an offer to go to the nearest hostelry, and we'll continue there. That is the end of that one, other than to say, welcome to you all. You're a very important part of the process. Welcome to those that will be watching this as it's being videoed for adaptation at some stage in the future. And if you are armed with a smart or otherwise mobile communication device, would you do to it whatever is necessary so that it doesn't interfere with the proceedings during the course of the evening? Thank you very much. Are there any declarations of interest? It would appear not, so I shall hand straight over to the officer, Kevin Steptoe, to take us into this piece. Oh, sorry, I beg your pardon. Not on here. Yeah, you'll notice the minutes of the previous meeting. They have actually been ratified by the council, but would you formally agree to accept them with me? Thank you very much. Okay, over now, delay to Kevin to take us into the next phase.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Just to, at this stage, just very briefly introduce the application you have on the agenda tonight. There is only one application before you, and this is the application for site ASR 5 at Bishop Stortford North. Members will recall that the council has dealt with applications for the remaining of the areas of special restraint, that's the ASR areas 1 to 4, previous meetings, and has also dealt with an application ASR 5 before. Just to check that members have the documents with them, there is of course the main committee report that has with it essential reference papers A, C1, C2 and C3. And following that, as a further addition that followed on later, essential reference paper B, which was handed out this evening, which is the list of proposed conditions if members are minded to support the development proposals you have. You also have, just to make sure members have all the documents, you also have tonight again one additional paper, which is further representations we received post the publication of the report, and that is just a one page this evening of additional comments from the council solicitor and from the county council's development services team. So that's to make sure you have all the right documents. Chairman, as I say, this is an application for the remaining sector of the areas of special restraint that the council has not granted planning permission for. So ASRs 1 to 4 planning permission is now in place for those areas of land. This is the remaining area of Bishop Stortford North that members are being asked to consider tonight. I will go into more detail following the speakers and obviously in response to members' queries and questions. But at this stage, just to introduce it as an application that provides for 329 new homes and the provision of a site for a one-form primary school. So that's the context, that's the scope of the development, Chairman, and pass back to you now for the speakers.
Lovely, thank you very much, Mr. Steptoe. Right, to move on now to speakers from the floor, we have a number of people who wish to speak against. We have John Rose, Rob Francis, David Royal and Andy White. Between them they have 30 minutes. Could I ask John Rose to join us up here and make himself comfortable?
I'll try.
And the the clock of doom will start when you're ready, and only when you're ready. So let's name.
Mr. Chairman, would I either see the clock of doom or read my speaking notes, but not both at the same
well,
time?
Well, we'll bomb you.
So if somebody could give me
we
a
can.
Bit of warning when I've got a minute or two to go, that would be
good. No problem.
Thank you.
Sounds like it. This application largely repeats the one for which you refused permission, or your committee did, in April of this year. And so some of my criticisms will also be a repetition of those made to the previous committee. We do not doubt that ASR 5 will be developed as part of the overall development of Bishopsthorpe North. But this application is premature, and having been with council since May, it's difficult to understand why it should have been rushed before you at a special meeting with less than a week's notice in the middle of August. The main reason that your office has advanced for approving this application now is that East Hearts Council cannot demonstrate that it has available a 5-year supply of land for new housing. There are a couple of points I'd like to make about this. Firstly, it's an obligation which applies to the district as a whole. Bishopsthorpe alone in ASRs 1 to 4 has already provided land with planning permission for a housing total equivalent to 3 years supply for the whole of the district. It isn't taken entirely into account because developers ration the release of dwellings to avoid flooding the market and keep prices up. So adding another 329 houses to be developed in the same area and at the same time as ASRs 1 and 2 is not actually going to do anything to address the reality of the shortfall in housing there. The developers of ASRs 1 to 4 might simply slow down their rate of building, hard to see how they could go any slower than now, to compensate for any permission given for ASR 5. Bishopsthorpe has an ample supply of housing land without any need to grant permission for this application. It's the rest of the district that has the problem, and this application will do nothing to contribute to a solution. Nevertheless, as officers point out, since a 5-year supply of land cannot be demonstrated, the NPPF has to take precedence. The theme repeated many times in the NPPF is that while there may be a presumption in favour of development, it must be sustainable. This application, in our view, is not sustainable as a freestanding scheme. As proposed, it isn't an urban extension. There is no point at which it is contiguous with the built-up area of Bishopsthorpe. It's marooned between country lanes and the A120 bypass with very poor access arrangements. It's not within walking distance of any of the essential facilities needed to support it, medical facilities, shops, employment or the railway station. And if this were a standalone development, it would take more than a diverted bus service and a green travel plan to get people out of their cars. I'll talk about education in more detail later, but it's worth noting that this development will not be sufficient to fill the proposed JMI school. Children who take up the surplus places will have to be driven there. You have been counselled by officers not to introduce fresh grounds of objection when the main change from the previous application is the provision of a JMI school. I should say Mr. Steptoe in his introduction said simply provision of a site, but I understand that it actually includes provision of a school. However, this is a fresh application, time's moved on, and you are a new committee. You are entitled to reach your own judgment about whether this is sustainable as a freestanding development, and for the reasons I've given, we think it is not. If we move on to the more plausible assumption that this development is integral to the development of Bishopsthorpe and North as a whole, a number of issues need to be considered. I recall that when the scheme was last considered by the committee, the applicants argued that there was no significance in this ASR being number 5, and that development could just as easily start here as with ASRs 1 and 2. I don't think that was an entirely fair description of the position. The SAVE policies of the adopted local plan clearly envisage that ASRs 1 and 2 would be developed first, and the 3 and 5 will follow on later. While all the sites are being brought forward anyway, rather than some being held in reserve following a review of the local plan, you are entitled to rely on the plan's policy on the sequence in which the Bishop's Stall for the North site should be developed. It was certainly never the intention that development should start at opposite ends of the Bishop's Stall for the North at the same time, if only to minimise the chaos the construction traffic would cause. The need for a pause following the development of ASRs 1 and 2 was also emphasised by local councillors in debating the grant of planning permission for ASRs 1 to 4, because they were sceptical about the reliability of the traffic impacts which had been modelled. This too argues against starting development now on another part of Bishop's Stortford North. Apart from the JMI school, all the community facilities and social infrastructure on which development of ASR 5 will depend are to be provided in ASRs 3 and 4. Judging by the progress currently being made in developing ASRs 1 and 2, this could be many years away. Your officers airily say in paragraph 8.4.5 of their report that it's unfortunate but not uncommon that during the early phases of development, residents are less well served by community facilities and shops. The economics of the provision require that local residents are in place first. It's one thing to recognise that this may be the reality of a large development and may well be the case with ASRs 1 and 2. It's quite different actually to plan for that to occur, but that would be the result of approving this application. The consortium claim that contributions being offered for the community facilities which they'll provide in ASRs 3 and 4 are inadequate, and they will not have the slightest incentive to provide them any time soon. So the likely prospect is that this will be a freestanding development for years to come, separated from community facilities which would help to make it sustainable by a building site. In practice, it will be a dormitory suburb for car-dependent commuters, just like St Michael's Mead. Let's move on to education, because this is the rabbit which the applicants have pulled out of their hat by providing for a 1FE JMI school. Starting, though, with secondary education, the County Council have given themselves planning permission for a 6FE school which straddles the A120 bypass. Access to it will either be from Haddon Road or through ASRs 3 and 4. In the early years following opening, access to it from ASR 5, if granted permission now, could only be by car. Moreover, when the school opens, it will build up over several years, starting with the most junior forms. So parents of older children will necessarily have to send them to another Bishop's Stortford school. These are all full anyway at present, and can also only be accessed from ASR 5 by car. Finally, the development of this school depends upon a land swap for the site of Patmore Close, which will need to have planning permission granted for housing. That application has not yet come before you, and you may well find yourselves unable to grant it permission. So you cannot assume that there will be a speedy delivery of the additional secondary school places which Bishop's Stortford North as a whole will generate. And granting premature permission for housing on ASR 5 will simply leave residents there with teenage children driving to other Bishop's Stortford schools that will have no spare capacity to take them. Turning now to the proposed 1FE JMI school, the remarkable thing about this application is that you're being asked to grant planning permission for a facility which nobody wants. The County Council thinks it will be too small to offer a full range of educational opportunities or to be cost effective. The ASR 5 development alone will not be big enough to fill it, and countryside properties want to build homes, not schools. Moreover, if you look at the officer's report at the preferred strategy, it starts at paragraph 8.3.13, you will see that step one is for a 2FE school to be built within ASRs 1 and 2. With associated changes to housing provision. None of that has been agreed yet. Step two is for the consortium to buy back the primary school site on ASRs 3 and 4, with the County Council using the proceeds instead to acquire a different site for a 3-form entry school from the Town Council. This is subject to feasibility and price, and has also not been agreed yet. step three is this application, including one FE school, to be granted planning permission. You will see that there's no explanation as to why step three should be taken out of sequence and dealt with before steps one or two. Nor is there any explanation as to why it is so important to give planning permission to a school which nobody wants. Nor is there any justification for the claim at the end of this section of the report that you can have some confidence that the preferred strategy can be delivered. Understanding in simple chronology always seems to have been a problem with this application. It would surely make much more sense to await the completion of steps one and two so that you know what the strategy will be, rather than giving approval to a scheme now when it is no more than an insurance policy against the risk of the preferred strategy not being deliverable. Summing up, I would say that, firstly, that regarding the district's shortage of land for housing, the problem does not lie in Bishop Stortford, and granting permission for this application will do nothing to address it. The application is largely deficient of community facilities which might support it as a sustainable freestanding development. It will be so remote from any such facilities prior to the completion of ASRs 3 and 4 that it will become a car-dependent settlement. The 1FE school which the developers think will dispose of your previous objections to the scheme does nothing of the kind. Nobody wants it, and the County Council's preferred strategy has a number of important hurdles to clear before you can have any confidence in its implementation. Considering this application now, in my view, is a waste of time, and you should refuse permission. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It just helps you as well. Thank you, Mr. Rose. Thank you very much. Could I now call on Mr. Francis?
Well, Mr. Francis is unable to be with us today. So my name is Peter Hoffman, here for him.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Would you care to come up? You've been allocated 5 minutes. Are you comfortable with
this? Yes.
As before, make yourself comfortable, let us know when you're in a position to start.
Just so you can hear me.
And you'll need to turn the microphone on. I wonder if you pour yourself a glass in case you need a drop of water while you go through.
Thank you, Mr. Good evening, everybody. I'm here for the place of Rob Francis, as chairman of Chantry Community Association, who is somewhere in the wilds of Norfolk today. My name is Peter Hoff. I'm one of the secretaries of Chantry Community Association, which represents the interests of about 1,500 householders in the northwest part of Bishop Stortford. Our members remain very concerned about the application to develop a major housing estate on prime agricultural land. Only nominal attempts are proposed to mitigate the impact of over 1,000 new residents in the town, where the infrastructure is already insufficient and subject to the even larger developments on ASRs 1 to 4, which have yet to be realised. The application still shows zero understanding of the needs of the residents of Bishop Stortford, especially in the CCA area, and grossly understates the impact of these collective developments on the ASRs. Despite not joining the BSN consortium, the applicant is assuming that those other developments on ASRs 1 to 4 will provide most of the community facilities that are required in total. We note that the applicant has bowed to pressure and conceded that plans now include a one-form entry primary school on the site. Furthermore, the school... However, this is not in line with Harts County education policy. Furthermore, the school will not allow for future expansion, nor for incoming pupils from Elsenham, Stansted and the surrounding villages. Therefore, it would not be responsible to approve this application when the infrastructure issues have not even been agreed for ASRs 1 to 4, let alone implemented. Rye Street is already a very dangerous road for pedestrians and cyclists. Yet we feel the new application does not address the traffic issue identified in March, which is a major concern for residents. The addition of a new roundabout for access from ASR 5, together with a new T-junction for access from ASRs 3 and 4, will unavoidably cause havoc on Rye Street and Michael's Road. Our view is that the Section 106 funds being offered for the Rye Street improvement will fail to solve the situation that is basically insoluble. That is, an old road such as this cannot safely carry the additional volume of traffic that will result from all the developments. The smarter choices solution, as described in paragraph 12.118, etc., in the environmental statement, are not realistic and will not provide workable solutions to the traffic problems that already exist. In addition, crossing points will be needed in both Michael's Road and Hazel End Road for access to the so-called new green space. To summarise, we would ask the committee to refuse this application as it does not satisfy local plan save policies TR 1, 2, 10, 12, 17 and BIS 15 nor HDP 7. Nor TP 1 to 4 and EP 1 from the neighbourhood plan for Silverleys and Beads. The timing of the new and improved infrastructure related to all areas of developments has not been fully assessed. There are severe traffic problems that still await a full traffic survey, and the educational issues are not resolved at all. We would therefore ask you to delay the approval of ASR 5 until the impact of the agreed developments on ASRs 1 and 2 are first properly assessed. Furthermore, additional negotiations are required to ensure that existing residents are properly protected.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Hall.
Could I ask Mr. Royal to step forward, please?
Thank you, Mr. Royal.
Thank you, as before, 5 minutes.
Yes.
Are you able to sit, Clock, or would you like a nudge with him? Okay. Make yourself comfortable first.
I have two general questions, actually. I'm a very new councillor in Salisbury, and this is only the second Development Management Committee meeting I've attended. Nevertheless, I've already been immediately struck by the power of the NPPM and the compromises it provokes, and I have two general questions, therefore. First is about affordable housing. I refer to sections 8.2.6 and 8.2.21, and the recommendation to accept a compromise percentage well below the 2007 40% local plan target. A similar recommendation was accepted for the recently approved redevelopment of the site in South Street, the former Regent's Petroleum site. My question simply is, what is the current percentage of affordable housing in EHDC approved development projects, and how is this monitored and publicised? Second question is about housing mix, section 8.2.12. Bishop Stortford Town Council objections to South Street redevelopment about further unwanted flatted development based on a resident survey was overruled. Here the council's housing strategy is quoted to support the conclusion that a predominance of flatted development in recent years and the SHMA indicates there should be more of an emphasis on family homes. My question is, are planning criteria being consistently applied, and how is this monitored and publicised? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Roy. Mr. White in the room? Hello, Mr. White. You should be quite familiar with the process now.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Andy White, and I've lived in Bishop Stortford for the last 30 years. I chair the Friends of Southern Country Park group, which is a volunteer group that works with East Harts Council and Harts County Council to make that park a good and enjoyable place to visit for park users and to increase the biodiversity in the park. I'm also a member of Rob Francis's Green Spaces team on the Second Neighbourhood Plan for Bishop Stortford. So hopefully you will see from that I have a keen interest in protecting and enhancing our green spaces. And as I'm an amateur naturalist, in particular to improve biodiversity and to protect our wildlife in this area. I'm here tonight to object to any development on the old Farnham allotment site, which borders Rice Street and Farnham Road. And you probably heard earlier that this is a potential future site for a primary school. I and many others have visited this site for many years in what are really tranquil surroundings to observe and enjoy the wide range of wildlife that exists there. It really does provide an area to help maintain and improve your health and your well-being, it really does. The site is untouched, it's completely untouched, it's free from pesticides, and it's just the sort of area that wildlife really thrives in. There's a large covering of wild marjoram, which attracts many butterflies and large numbers of honeybees, bumblebees and other insects. And areas like this were important sites for our local bee population, particularly when you consider the recently approved use of neonicotinoids in our county. Other wildflowers and tall grasses provide food and safe haven for so many other species, including a wide range of birds and slow worms that I have personally seen on site. It is a real wildlife gem, and sites like this are fast disappearing. I have contacted the Bishop Stortford Natural History Society, and they sent me a communication earlier today that I'd just like to read out. It says, the old Farnham Road allotment site used to be a favourite haunt of members of the Natural History Society. They were particularly interested in the butterfly population, of which I think there were outstanding numbers of marbled white butterflies. It's a fairly uncommon species for this area. People also used to speak of the large number of slow worms and common lizards. The site would make an excellent nature reserve. The soil is dry, gravelly and poor, making it most unsuitable for allotments, which is why it was abandoned originally as an allotment site. The area is becoming scrubbed over and would need management to return it to its former open aspect. The conclusion is, from our point of view, is that it would have more value as a wildlife site than anything else. I also contacted the Hearts and Middlesex Wildlife Trust, and they said I should really read the MPPF. As many of you will understand, that filled me with some grief and trepidation, because I may be confronted with a language and terminology that I may not fully understand. However, I did find some plain speaking in the guidance document, point 118, which states, opportunities to incorporate biodiversity in and around developments should be encouraged. So let's grab that opportunity to protect this area, enhance it and actively manage it into a local nature reserve. It is ideally situated in close proximity to any housing development. It's a valuable natural asset for the town and its people. Please, let's not lose it.
Thank you very much, Mr. White. Can I call now on Mr. Michael Lambert, who has stated his intention to talk in support of this application. Mr. Lambert, same advice. You have, if you need it, 30 minutes.
Well, I think I can give you some early good news. I won't be taking 30 minutes of your time today. Good evening, Chairman members. My name's Mike Lambert, as you said. I'm Planning Director at Countryside Properties, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to you tonight. The decision you're being asked to make this evening clearly follows the refusal by the Development Management Committee in March. At that time, we presented proposals that, although in line with policy guidelines and the Council's own emerging district plan, clearly did not satisfy elected members on that committee. Although that refusal was against officers' advice and an appeal has been lodged, Countryside's preference is to work constructively to respond to the issues raised on that application and to try to find an acceptable compromise that avoids the need for a time-consuming and costly public inquiry. What you have before you tonight is broadly the same application, the principal difference being it no longer includes the details for Phase 1, which would now be the subject of a separate application for reserve matters, if indeed now planning consent were to be granted. We still propose to deliver 329 new homes, with considerable landscaping and public open spaces as before. However, we've given members' concerns at the last committee, we have reviewed both our education and affordable housing commitments. I'm pleased to confirm that our application this evening does provide the certainty that a one-form entry primary school can be accommodated within the development and could be delivered alongside the new homes. However, we are also very happy to continue to work with the County Council towards achieving their preferred solution for a three-form entry school on the land opposite our site on Farnham Road, to serve not just ASL 5 but the wider area. I hear what Mr Rhodes said before, but I think we firmly believe, and I think this has the support of the County Council, that a positive decision tonight will actually help deliver that preferred option. In other words, the County Council clearly have to go through a series of decisions, but without the certainty of knowing that there is a planning consent and a consequential Section 106 agreement that provides funding for the new schools, the County Council are not able to really move forward with that strategy. So we believe that we can be part of the solution, not just part of the problem. We've also resolved to increase the... Sorry, is that me? We've also resolved to increase the affordable housing contribution from 22 to 25%, and officers have examined that new proposal and endorsed that commitment and endorsed it. And we've agreed to do this while maintaining the overall Section 106 package at the same level as it was back in March. For those unfamiliar with Countryside, we are proud of our commitment to quality, and hopefully you will have received an email from our communications consultant with details setting out our ethos and our track record. It's been mentioned tonight, but those with longer memories will recall that our development of new community at St Michael's Mead, to the southwest of Bishop's Stortford, during the mid-1990s, when we worked closely with the council and development partners to contribute almost £5 million to the funding of St James's Way and deliver a place of recognised quality. We want to continue working with East Harts District Council and Bishop Stortford Town Council well into the future through the emerging local plan and the neighbourhood plans for the town. I trust this brief statement gives you some reassurance that we intend to be here in Bishop Stortford for the long term and that we've reacted as positively as we could to the refusal in March. Today's application will bring over 300 new jobs to the area, contributing £10 million to the local economy. Over £3.3 million of new homes bonus payments will be made to the local authority, in addition to the extra half a million per annum this development would generate in council tax. In addition to a contribution of £5.3 million towards education provision and free land for a one-form entry on our site, our other Section 106 commitments of £2.4 million for everything from local roads to new bridleways and footpaths complete a funding package that will, I believe, make a positive difference to the town and the wider district. I understand I may not be required to answer any questions from the committee tonight, but if there are any, and with the chairman's permission, I'd be happy to do this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lennon. Kevin, over to you.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you very much. I was intending now, Chairman, just for members' benefit, just to give a bit more detail about the proposal. Obviously, you've heard quite a lot of detail there, and I may be able to pick up on some of the points that were made to give members, again, a bit more context around some of those. So we've heard that you have in front of you an outline application. It's for all matters are to be reserved, so there's no detail in front of you apart from you have the detail of the proposed accesses to the site, three of those in number from Hazel End Road and Farnham Road, and you know that you have a maximum number of houses of 329 new homes proposed, and we have a site that the proposal is for the provision of a site for a one-form entry primary school. Now, of course, because this is outline application, if members support this evening, and if the land is called on for the primary school, there will indeed be in place a permission in principle then for the provision of a one-form entry primary school on site. So that refers back to the point that Mr. Rhodes was making there. The application has been with us for over two years, in fact, so I appreciate May was referred to. It's actually been with us since May 2013. So we certainly don't see this as rushing anything for members. It's been with the authority for over 2 years, and in that time, there has been a ongoing discussions with the applicants, and a number of amendments have been made to the scheme. When it first arrived with us, it was for a total of up to 450 new homes, and subsequently revised, firstly down to 360, or with then with the potential for a school site to be included, the 329 number, and finally subsequently amended again to make it certain that it would be no more than 329, and that the site is definitely provided if called upon by the County Council for the Wunthorne Entry Primary School. You've heard that a second application for the site was dealt with in March of this year by the Development Management Committee. That application at the time was a hybrid application, so it had the details of a first phase. The overall numbers were the same, but there was details of the first phase in front of the committee. Members at the time were not satisfied with the arrangements for delivery of infrastructure in relation to the development, and permission was refused, and your report at 2.4 contains that previous refusal reason. In a very simple nutshell, it was that members were concerned about the arrangements for the delivery of primary education, and that the scope of affordable housing provision on the site was considered to be inadequate, so not sufficient. So that was the scope of the reason for refusal at that time. So the changes have taken place since March, and in the ongoing dialogue that has been taking place with the applicants, you've heard that affordable housing percentage has been increased from where we were back in March at 22.5% of the overall homes on the site up to 25% now, and there has been no change to the other provisions of the Section 106 agreement that's in front of you. So the applicants haven't sought, if you like, by making that additional provision, haven't sought to recover any costs by reducing funding for other service areas. We have a change, however, in the proposed tenure arrangement of the affordable housing. So back in March, we were looking at a 70%, 30% split between affordable rented and shared ownership units of that affordable housing number, where now we have in front of us a 60-40 split affordable rent to shared ownership. So there's been a change in that respect. There's also been a further change in the respect of the phasing on the site. So this is all in outline, so this is the current understanding. Reserve matters applications would come forward if members supported this tonight. But whereas back in March there were to be three phases, affordable housing was to be provided only in the first and the third of those phases, and the council's housing officers were concerned about the break in provision of affordable housing because of that. The applicants now propose that there still be three phases, but affordable housing is provided in each one of those three phases, so there's a smoother spread of the delivery of affordable housing. I can just pause at that point because there was a question put by one of the speakers about what is our position in relation to affordable housing, and I can just remind members about that. I know it's a subject that we cover in almost every committee meeting. The council's policy is to seek up to 40% of development on any given site as affordable housing units, and affordable housing units are units that are subsidised in some way by, in this case, the developer and or the price that's paid for those units. So there's some subsidy element somewhere, so they're not open market housing. We heard the speaker refer to the other site, the Regent Garage site in South Street in Bishop Stortford, and indeed there very recently the authority has accepted a scheme with 21% affordable housing units. We have dealt with, to give members other examples, a similar size scheme in Buntingford for 316 units, is where we've accepted 22.5%. We have been tested on appeal in a number of occasions, and a very recent appeal decision that the council has dealt with delivered affordable housing at 19.8%. So an appeal inspector felt that a lower, an under 20% provision was acceptable. Ultimately, the decision must relate to the circumstances of each individual site. So you can't necessarily make a simple comparison like that across those sites. Each one will have its own set of particular circumstances, costs of development and potential value of that development, which will have an impact on affordable housing provision. What is constant is that, again, the National Planning Policy Framework, the NPPF, makes clear that we should not seek to, by ensuring that we deliver affordable housing in full, prevent development from coming forward. So we've got the message is we have to reach a balance, and of course that balance is different in each of those circumstances. Where do we publicise and monitor our affordable housing? The council publicises its delivery each year in its annual monitoring report, so that it is a public. The provision over any previous year is public, and it's publicised by the council, and people are more than welcome to dip into that, and it's on the council's website. And I appreciate these documents can be difficult to find, but with a bit of signposting, we can point people to that. So, change in relation to affordable housing. The other change, Chairman, really just for members, is to share with members like a bit more of the progress that's been made, and it's set out in the report, the progress that's been made in relation to primary education delivery, because that was an area that members were concerned about when they considered this matter back in March. And we've heard that the ASRs 1 to 4 will deliver, as it currently stands, two primary school sites. One is a one form entry site and one is a three form entry site. And we know that the County Council, as the education provider, does not favour, it's not their optimal solution to provide one form entry primary schools. There are efficiencies in terms of operation, management, curriculum, educational achievement, by having larger schools, so two form entry or greater. So one form entry schools are not their preferred. However, ultimately, we have to consider the proposals that are in front of us as a freestanding application. It's being proposed as an application has come forward. We have to consider it on the basis of its own merits. And as it stands, we've heard that land is to be provided that's sufficient for one form entry. And we've also heard that the child yield that's likely to be generated from the development of this site will not fill in its entirety a one form entry school. So effectively, there is additional land over and above that required, but of course the county is not in the business of providing less than a one form entry school. Plainly, that wouldn't be sensible. So one form entry land is provided and funding provided sufficient to meet the 0.7 form entry product, the child yield that's delivered as a result of this site. So the applicants here are delivering sufficient to meet the needs that they are generating. We know there are pressures in Bishopsthorpe in relation to schools across the town. We know that there is an ideal scenario that obviously primary school children are schooled very close to where they live, for both sustainability in terms of transport, but obviously in terms of building relationships with their peer group. At secondary level, of course, students do travel further to their schooling. But in terms of what this site generates, it meets its need. However, what we're saying to members in the report is that over and above that, the County Council has a more optimum strategy, and its preference is to reach a position where it's delivering one two-form entry school on the consortium site, ASR 1 to 4, and a further three-form entry site, three-form entry school on third-party land. Now, that optimum strategy is not yet in place. There are a number of steps, and you heard them referred to in the report. What we're saying to members is this does not prevent any of that strategy taking place, and in fact we believe it assists in the delivery. However, if ultimately it's not delivered, the education need from this development is catered for. Chairman, that's the further detail I just wanted to provide members with around the scheme you have in front of you. Just to touch on, there was a couple of points that the speakers raised that would probably be helpful just to comment on. In relation to housing land supply, I understand the point entirely around the generation of need across the district. Members will know that a number of our settlements are coming under development pressure from schemes that are coming forward from applicants because they're able to cite that the council has less than 5 years worth of land available for housing delivery. So yes, Bishop Stortford has played its part. Other settlements have also played their part across the district. The permission, if it were to be granted on this site, would count. It's not the case that it wouldn't count, it would count. In fact, it's already relied upon in the council's case when it argues that it does have at least 2 to 3 years worth of supply. And of course, if we're not to support it, that has a harmful impact on our current position. So it would count. The applicants and the consortium, we understand the position that, of course, all developers will not flood the market simultaneously, but of course will regulate the delivery of their supply and their development as suitable to ensure take-up of their product. So, Chairman, housing land supply is a crucial element for us. Again, it's one we touch on in every meeting, and certainly this does have an impact in relation to it. Chairman, it's probably best if I leave it at those points at the moment, and of course I'll try and assist members if I have questions and queries.
Thank you very much, Kevin. It is at this point in the meeting that I now turn to members for their contribution, but we do have with us local member Keith Warnell, who would like to address us as a local member.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you to the speakers for some very interesting points. And I had some views on this which would lead me to believe that there are some policies that are not being complied with here, but of course I'm open to suggestions from other members. But this land has been earmarked for development since the 1980s. It's been agreed for that purpose. And I'm not particularly against that, but I'm not happy about development at any cost. The site itself is actually isolated from ASRs 1 and 2, and three, the development of 3 and 4 is sometime way in the future. So I'm still concerned over the isolation of this site, where residents have no local facilities, no doctors, shops, community facilities. And like the education issue that I will, like other speakers, turn to, these lack of facilities will not only be inconvenient for residents, but they will result in what they call trip generation, which in other words we know as traffic. As I suspect that the incoming residents to this development that's on the edge of town will not wish to rely on buses and walking. And the necessary facilities that people need are in some considerable way from this very edge of town site. I certainly welcome the change in the shared ownership percentages, as the people of this town actually showed in a neighbourhood plan survey to every household that. The requirement for shared ownership properties in Bishop Stortford was very close behind the requirement for new properties, and the private and social sort of rented accommodation was quite some distance away. Education. Now, others have referred to this, and I'm going to as well. The education aspect does not seem to be fulfilled. It's been referred to that capacity exists in ASRs 1 and 2, when built, but then that puts it out of step time-wise with ASR5. Well, maybe if an amicable arrangement is reached between Harts County Council and Bishopsthorpe Town Council over the purchase of some form of allotment of land to build a bigger school. For a second, I'll put another hat on. As Chairman of Bishopsthorpe Council's Finance Committee, I can inform you that no such deal is before that committee, or the council generally. And should Harts County Council come up with an offer, I believe that Bishopsthorpe Council is duty bound to seek the best value for its assets. However, if this is not to be, the educational demand cannot sensibly be met within BSM on the grounds that, as has been said, the school has just about enough, but there's no room for expansion. And proposals suggest that pupils can attend other schools in the area outside Bishopsthorpe of North. My understanding is that there is a crisis of primary school places in Bishopsthorpe generally, and wherever they are accommodated will create school run traffic, the bane of life in this town. Plus, of course, those children will be stuck in those schools some distance away from their peer groups and their homes until they move to senior school, which isn't just a week or two away, it's quite a considerable time. So, I did say that I believe this may contravene some planning policies. Not a huge amount has changed since the last application was refused, and I believe that this still contravenes the local plan's IMP1, and it definitely 100% contravenes the local plan policy's EP1, school availability, and EP3, the new primary schools policy. And the neighbourhood plan policies are fundamental to Bishopsthorpe North, and they cannot and should not be disregarded. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Keith. Right, over to you, members. Just the members, please. Okay. Indicate if you wish for clarification or you wish to comment. Councillor Mundy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you as well to the speakers, it's much appreciated, and for everyone who's turned out this evening. It's difficult for arguably some councillors, like myself, to address applications like this, which have been around for so long, because many of us are in fact new councillors as of May this year. But we have taken the time to look into the detail of the application. And there's 120 odd pages in the report here, and taking account of the fact that this application in a slightly different form was reviewed in March of 2015, and it was refused on the basis of the primary school provision. And so my understanding is that from looking at the history and the officer's report and conclusions, that the main focus, to a large extent at this meeting for this committee, is really focused around the primary school provision and the forms of entry across ASR 1 to 4 and 5. And notwithstanding that, one would then think, well, there are 120 pages in front of us in terms of the officer's report. There's a lot more in here than just the primary school provision, but my understanding is that a great deal of that has in fact been discussed and agreed, and that the refusal that was made in March was indeed just in relation to the primary school provision. So it's very difficult to think, for myself, at least speaking for myself, to focus on too much on any of the other issues which have already been discussed in March. For instance, traffic issues, congestion issues, the fact that, in fact, the population of the town would increase by 16% if this was fully implemented across ASR 1 to 5. And there are a myriad of issues, there are archaeology issues, but my understanding is that all of these additional issues outside of the education ones are mitigated to some extent by specific section 106 contributions, the financial contributions that are going to be made to the community and to highways provision improvement, in the provision of a roundabout, etc., and subsidising bus provision from the site to the rest of the town. I need to focus upon, for my part, really this primary school provision. Because if the developers are providing, I think it's £7.6 million in terms of Section 106 contributions, very specifically, that addresses many of the concerns that I think the community have in terms of the impact that the site will have, and that essentially we need to draw our attention to that primary school provision. And I don't really know where to begin to focus upon what the issues might be about one form entry, two form entry, three form entry. It is quite complex. My understanding is that the developers for ASR5 are proposing a one form entry school, and that's really what we're discussing. Can the officers provide us just a little bit more information about one form entry and two form entry and the location of the primary school provision on the site? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to say that's some fairly astute comments there, so I'm going to ask Kevin to deal with those straight away.
Thank you, Chairman. Yes, I appreciate it is a very complex situation in relation to the education provision. So I'll hopefully address that again in more detail with the members. So starting off obviously with primary school provision first, there are two ways in which we need to give consideration to this. One is in relation to the development scheme that you have in front of you now, so this application for 329 new homes. And then because it's material, it's reasonable for members to have regard to the wider perspective, which of course is the rest of the development that may take place across the whole of Bishop Stortford North, and of course we've heard the context of the town together. So it's reasonable for members to be aware of that and factor it into their consideration. But ultimately you're considering a scheme, a planning application for 329 new homes on this site. So starting from the perspective of the site in the first place, the County Council in their response to us has provided from the benefit of their demographic work and their knowledge of how schools, how the demand for school places is generated across the county, have provided the information on which we've based the recommendations for you. So 833 and 834 of the report, you'll see that for primary school provision for this site, ASR5, there is the demand for school places builds up to a peak and then tends to subside again in the longer term. And that's because new developments of some size, which is this clearly some size of development here, tend to generate a demand. New families move in, families that have young children, generates that demand builds up to a peak. Then those families tend to stay on site, even though of course their children move through the school system into secondary school and beyond. So that's the profile, and that's commonly agreed. So you'll see that 834, we have a demand here at the peak level for 0.7 form of entry. Now form of entry is 30 places, 30 school places across each year group. So years 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on as children go through the school system. There is no dispute about that school demand, that's the generation of children. There's no dispute about that between the county and the developer, and we're being advised very much by the county in this respect, and we have no reason to dispute it. So that's agreed, and we've heard that on this side the applicants are providing land that's sufficient to deliver a one form entry school. So in terms of land, there is sufficient available in order to be able to build a school that would accommodate one form entry of children at primary school age. So the 0.7 is accommodated. In terms of funding, we've heard that the developer has been willing to provide less than the funding that would be required to deliver one form of entry school, because they're saying, quite reasonably so, they're saying, well, we generate 0.7, we will fund that. But we believe the Education Authority should find other sources for delivering the rest of the funding. And in the reference paper B, the section 106 funding arrangements, the figure is, put my fingers on it for you, the figure is of course 2.45 million is providing the funding. The County Council Education Authority has accepted that position, so there is a need for them to generate additional funds from other sources to be able to deliver a one-form entry school on a site. But they've accepted that position, and on that basis we are able to say for members that this site, within its own resources, will deliver a solution for education at primary school level. However, members it's quite reasonable for members to look at the wider perspective here, because we've heard there's a lot of other development taking place around the site. So ASR 1 to 4, and this is, members have to take a view on this, because on the one hand we've heard, well actually, will they all take place at once and deliver housing land supply? But yet when it comes to school provision, there's concern that they will all deliver at once and overburden the education system. Our belief is that they will certainly both take place at the same time and deliver new housing which will generate demand for schools. So across the whole of ASR 1 to 5, again looking on that same page in the report, you'll see that there the peak need for primary school places for the whole of ASR 1 to 5 at its highest is 5 forms of entry. Now, again, in terms of the ability to deliver across ASRs 1 to 5, we've heard that the current situation is that ASR 1 to 4 will deliver a 1 times 1 form entry plus a 1 times 3 form entry, gives us 4, and we have on this side another one that gives us 5. I do feel it is not correct for us to say that actually this site cannot, these combined sites cannot deliver their overall need. The accepted figure is 5 form entry, and these sites in combination deliver 5 forms of entry. And indeed, the peak subsides to 3 form entry after, you'll see it's, peak is over, 3 form entry for 15 years, so it's a long period of time, and over 4 for 9 years, but subsides eventually to 2.8 forms of entry. So, albeit a very considerable time in the future, the developers here are providing 5 form entry, which would only be effectively almost 3/5 filled by their development need. So they're accommodating the peak. So for the overall site, it accommodates the whole demand. So from both perspectives, this site and itself on its own and the combined site, sufficient is delivered. Then there's a question of, is it delivered at the right time? Of course, that's the next concern that we have. We also know as it stands at the moment, that ASR 1 to 4 is working towards the delivery of a single form entry school that will open in September 2017, with the ability to obviously accommodate the children first start to come to live on the site. We've heard, of course, that the County Council's aspiration is for that actually to be a 2 form entry school, because that will give additional flexibility for the school to accommodate demand both from ASR 1 to 4 plus ASR 5, the site in front of you now. However, ultimately, if that optimal solution is not achieved, the legal agreement that would be put in place in relation to this site would require early delivery of the one form entry school on this site to then enable it to start to accommodate the need for the development of this site. So I would say to members that ultimately, if you like, the longer term solution about the potential for relocating the second school on ASR 4 onto other land that we've heard is Town Council interest is really not particularly material to the actual proposals in front of you now. It's more material in relation to the longer term development of ASRs 1 to 4. That development, as you know, delivers 2,200 homes as opposed to the 329 you're looking at tonight. So we understand, of course, that there is agreement is yet to be reached, and of course, all of those provisions we heard about have to be met. But ultimately, I'd say to members that, in terms of materiality of that tonight, that is limited in relation to this site. So that all relates to primary education, and then secondary education, of course, is relevant as well. Back in March this year, members considered the proposals and did not refuse them on the basis of secondary schooling. So there are no changes in circumstances that we would advise you should lead you to a different decision. But just to ensure members are fully informed, secondary school provision is by an arrangement for the ASR 1-4 land, a land swap agreement between the consortium developers and the county council in relation to other land that they hold, that enables provision of land within the ASR 1-4 site for a 6-form entry secondary school. And you'll see again in the paper here that the actual peak demand for ASR 1-5 is 4.9. We have there an additional form of entry over and above that generated by the development of ASR 1-5. What would happen if that fell through, that land swap arrangement? There was a question that was raised by one of the speakers earlier on. What would happen if that fell through? If that falls through, the position that the authority has agreed in relation to ASR 1-4 by granting planning permission there is that there would be funding delivered by the consortium sufficient to develop a new school at another site. Now, where would that site be? That would have to be a matter to be dealt with at that time. Clearly, the County Council do have other land holding. Whether it would be suitable, sufficient in that respect for a school would have to be explored. But the funding has been provided and the authority has accepted that position. And what we're saying in relation to the proposal in front of you now is that the same arrangements are in place. Sufficient funding is provided for the additional, and this one again is generating 0.7 form of entry of secondary school places, such that it's meeting its need. And just in respect to that point, Chairman, I think it is probably helpful to turn to, as we've heard, the neighbourhood plan policies should indeed be given weight. In making their decision, members have to balance the weight that they give to all the material issues and the material issues include, of course, the neighbourhood plan policies. EP1 is new developments will only be acceptable if primary school places are made available for all additional children within or immediately adjacent to the neighbourhood area. And they are. The 5-form of entry is all within the neighbourhood area. Secondary school places are available in Bishop Stortford in schools that are reasonably accessible from the proposed development. In this case, the school is proposed to be developed within ASR 1-4 with a caveat I said earlier. So again, we say it's certainly within Bishop Stortford and it's certainly reasonably accessible. So our advice is that policy is indeed met. EP3 is the one about timing. This goes back to primary schools. Primary schools are to be built in the neighbourhood area in line with the growth in population, so marrying up growth in population to delivery of school, taking into account the available capacity of existing schools. We don't seek to rely on any existing capacity. We know that primary schools in Bishop Stortford are full, so we don't seek to rely on any of that. Such schools, if delivered as 1-form entry schools, must be designed to ensure that they have the capability of expanding to at least 2-form entry at a later date. Now, that's the area where we say we can't accommodate that aspect of the policy, but what we do accommodate is by virtue of 3 sites potentially across the whole of ASR 1-5, accommodate the need for 5 forms of entry of schooling at primary level overall across the development. So we haven't got the individual flexibility of every school being able to expand, but we've got the forms of entry across the overall site. And Chairman, nice as it would be able to, of course, build in flexibility to expand every school, we feel there is a balance to be achieved here, and what we've put in front of members and what the developers have come forward with is an acceptable one. Sorry, Chairman, it is a very complex, it is a complex area, and I do hope that's assisting members. I suppose the only element in finishing on that point, really, as members rightly said, back in March, the concern was about your comfort that schooling could be delivered. We feel that the optimum solution has moved on a number of steps, but you still have comfort that schooling can be provided within the site if that optimum solution makes no further progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. Can I just check, Adrian, you're comfortable with that?
I think a brief comment from you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, no, that's perfect. I'm not going to dwell on this at all. You've gone into it in a great deal of detail. I just wanted to say that following my last comments, where I got somewhat tongue-tied, I have to admit, the difficulty was, I think for all of us, is that the report obviously mentions archaeology, sustainable drainage systems, all sorts of other aspects to this proposal. And I think it's just difficult for us because there are so many things that I think we might like to comment upon, but in essence our hands are tied because they've already been discussed. And I say that perhaps more for the benefit of the public and the webcast than anything else, because I think we all know this. This has been discussed at length, which is why we're focusing on the primary school issue. Because for instance, for my part, I would be concerned, for instance, about the health provision on the site. The phrases like, there is likely to be a health centre, gives me concern, for instance. But that's not something that arguably we can go into in detail at this meeting. Or in fact, indeed the traffic congestion, but we're not going to develop on that at this meeting because it has already been discussed in March. And I just wanted to say that again, that's what I was trying to say earlier. Hence the focus on the primary school issue. And that we're very much driven because of the NPPF to focus our attention and give the NPPF policies a great deal of weight in this case because of that issue of 5-year land supply for housing. Notwithstanding, you know, the neighbourhood plan for Leeds and Silverleys. So I'm just very, very conscious of that, and I'm just saying out loud perhaps what some of us in the panel are thinking. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Edgar. I've got Councillors Page, Aldridge and Cartwright who have indicated they'd like to speak, and I'm going to call them in that order. So, Councillor Page.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd just like to take up where Councillor McNeice left off, because I think that the report that's before us tonight, in certain instances, has been spun to accommodate this application. Councillor Warnell tonight mentioned that there's been no agreement between the Town Council and the County in regard to the Farnham Road allotments. I've drawn the officer's attention to this in the recent past. It still appears in the report as almost a done deal, which is nowhere near a done deal. The Town Council merely agreed to the County Council undertaking a feasibility study, pure and simple. That was the end of it. Then later on in the report, there is mention of the previous meeting where the application was then turned down. 9.2 on page 74, and I quote, "The committee must be mindful that when in March it considered whether the hybrid application, now at appeal, was sustainable development, it concluded that all matters were satisfactory apart from primary provision and affordable housing." Nowhere is there any evidence at all that that committee agreed that all matters were satisfactory. There was lengthy debate and lengthy criticism, particularly of the transport aspects associated with this development. That statement is just spun to indicate something which is completely untrue. There was plenty of criticism about matters other than education and affordable housing, and that statement that you make in 9.2 has no evidence in any minutes of meeting of Development Control Committee. Going on in 9.2, it says the report covers all the matters previously considered, but unless significant new evidence has emerged in the interim regarding these other matters, it would be inadvisable for the committee to determine that they do not represent sustainable development on this occasion. I'd like a legal opinion as to whether we should be prevented from discussing the wider aspects of this application tonight and only bearing down on the affordable housing and the education matters. Thank you, Chairman.
Simon. Thank you, Chairman. The point about 9.2 is that the reasons given for refusal of the previous application in March related to the issues set out in that. The committee did not refuse it on any other grounds. The only way it can refuse this application on other grounds is if it can be shown that the circumstances have changed, and members would then have to identify in what way those circumstances have changed.
Thank you. Thank you. Councillor Aldridge.
Thank you, Chairman. Just on a slightly different note, one of the speakers earlier was talking about how this development could be quite isolated. Because, you know, having been around it, it is slightly further out of town, and so people can't get in very easily, and therefore there may be traffic going in and out, which can cause problems. I was just wondering, therefore, what discussions have there been, or kind of what scope is there for designating certain buildings in this development once it's decided as sort of retails or shops? I'm not talking lots and lots, but with 329 houses, if there were a few convenience stores in there, then surely that would actually reduce the traffic potential for people going out of town. It would make it more sustainable itself. I was just wondering what kind of discussions there have been, if there have been any.
Thank you. Councillor Cartwright.
I have a similar issue to Councillor McNeice in that I feel our hands are slightly tied in discussing the previous refusal, which was on two issues. It was on education and affordable housing. Both of those issues, which appear to have been somewhat addressed by the developer, and I think the judgment that we all have to make, and I am trying to make, is whether the developer has gone far enough on those two issues in order for us to change our view. But I'm wondering if, having got two key aspects of that, I wasn't a councillor at that time and I wasn't at the meeting, but when you've got two significant issues of that magnitude in front of you, whether other issues, which may be large but not as large, don't need to be written down as reasons for refusal because you've got two big ones to go on. So I'm really troubled by not being able to look at some of the other issues in this proposal, and the one I am going to break rank and say that the one that really does bother me, we talked briefly about primary school, at length about primary school education, in particular the provision, which I understand, and the timing, which I understand, has been explained very well. We've also touched on secondary education. The one thing I haven't heard and cannot see from this, and apologies if it's there, is the timing aspect of secondary school provision. Because if this is a standalone development, if you build 329 houses, you might assume wrongly that newly married couples would come and there would be children being produced that ramp up. That's not the case. The people that buy these houses will have secondary school children from day one. And where are they going to go? And I'm very concerned about the situation in Bishop Stortford with the secondary education that it is. It turns a difficult situation into a crisis. And I haven't heard anything that allays my concern that the secondary school provision in ASR 1 to 4 will be developed in time for the ASR 5 going ahead at this stage. So I take your point about the issues of primary education and affordable housing, but I'm really sat here very uncomfortable about secondary education provision timing.
Thank you for that. I'm going to, I'm conscious that Keith wants to come back and Councillor Allen wants to contribute, but I'm going to ask Kevin to deal with those three submissions, if you will.
Chairman, yes, in relation to, I'm just really mirroring Simon Drinkwater's comments just now about the wider aspects of the application and what was members' position back in March. the resolution that the committee reached was that it refused the application for those two, on the focus of those two main issues. So it was the extent and delivery of primary school education and the acceptability of the affordable housing provision. The position, Chairman, is if members felt that the proposals they had in front of them at that time were unacceptable in other respects, then we should have articulated that. We may well have, I'm sure, and you know, my recollection, of course, as well, is that a whole range of issues were discussed, but ultimately members focused on those two areas of ultimate concern. So, Mr. Drinkwater has said to you that unless the circumstances have changed, and our advice to you is that in respect of other issues, the circumstances haven't changed, that reopening them to further comment is taking the council into a position where it is being unreasonable in its consideration of the proposals, because it's drawing up issues now that it didn't raise at an earlier stage. Having said that, and it was helpful that members did refer to the issue about the other aspects of the proposals there in the secondary schooling. The situation in relation to the secondary schooling, of course, we've heard that the County Council is pursuing the option that ASR 1 to 4 allows it in terms of calling for land within that site and entering into a land swap agreement with the development consortium. That has been achieved. The County Council has applied, submitted an application to itself to, as it's able to do so in relation to schooling provision, and granted permission for secondary education provision. Now, in terms of the precise opening date, I cannot at this stage give members a specific figure, because it's subject to a set of arrangements around the ability of the County Council to achieve access to the land that it can call upon to develop up its scheme and to deliver it. But what I would say is that as the authority that obviously is charged with ensuring that there are sufficient secondary school places available, it is more than aware, we have regular and ongoing contact with members of the County's Education and Property Services team. It is more than aware of the very pressing need in the town, and is using all of the actions it can in its best endeavours to ensure it delivers at an appropriate time. I would say that it's sufficient for us to be satisfied that as the authority responsible for delivering that, they are acutely aware of the ability of the requirement to ensure that that provision is made. So it was, I'm sure we did discuss it back in March, Chairman, and it was an element we were satisfied at that time. And in terms of the circumstances, they haven't changed in terms of relation of number of units, the demand. What has changed is, of course, that steps have been made by the County Council to bring forward the provision. So can you be more comforted by that? I would say members can, further steps have been made. The question about, the only point I would make at this moment about obviously the highway's impact, because that's clearly members are concerned about that, and many residents raise that as a concern, is that the modelling that's taken place in relation to this site was on the basis of the first submissions that were made to the authority. So that's on the basis of the 450 unit scheme with no primary school provided within the site. So that modelling was on the basis that all education would take place off the site, so all journeys would take the children off the site to schools elsewhere across the town and possibly elsewhere at both primary and secondary education level. So it's on that basis that the Highway Authority has assessed the proposals and found them to be acceptable. And what their advice to us is, and it seems entirely acceptable, is that, of course, now with a potential for schooling to be provided on the site, it is likely that some of that traffic will be reduced because obviously families will be taking their children to school on the site. But even if it wasn't, even if there was absolutely no reduction in that traffic impact, that's the basis on which the Highway Authority have assessed it. So I say again, members can be comforted that there's a buffer there, if you like. We've got flexibility that it has been considered on a very worst case basis. Hopefully, Jim, that addresses those couple of points.
Excellent, thank you very much. Councillor Allen.
Thank you, Chairman. I just would like to raise the issue on that transport because I think that's a fundamental change from what it was originally, and quite honestly, that I am concerned, along with the other councillors, that the traffic modelling, whilst it was based on 450 houses originally, does not represent the current plan, and quite simply will cause more problems than actually just simply stating that 329 homes with one form entry school will be less problematic than 450 homes, I think is inappropriate. And quite simply, a new transport modelling plan needs to be introduced. It's a difficult area of the town. The traffic is problematic at best. And I think with a one form entry school that's not full, it's more than likely that they will be drawing students from outside the area. And I'd like to see an amended traffic management plan before I would be comfortable. Thank you.
I can comment, Chairman's invited me to comment on that. Again, I'm not sure there's much I can add to comments previously. It's certainly not, I advise, it's an unreasonable position that the modelling that's currently taking place is robust because it's been modelled on that 121 more homes than that is actually now proposed. So a significant number in over and above that now proposed. But also on the basis, as I say, that all trips to educational facilities would be generated on the site and go elsewhere. Of course, there would be the normal arrangement where some of course, would be foot on foot, some would be by bus, but we accept the majority would probably be by private car. So the modelling that's been done seems to us to be a very robust, incredibly robust. In fact, it would be entirely unreasonable of us to insist on modelling on that basis because it's far in excess of what the developers are now actually proposing. But that's what's taking place. Yes, it is different to the scheme we have. And we know that the primary school now proposed is filled, if you like, 70% filled from the development on the site and 30% by potentially 30% from other locations. But of course, that traffic is travelling to the site rather than away from it, and by far the highest peaks in terms of traffic are transport away from the site, people travelling to work. So, Chairman, it remains the case, it must be that the transport modelling that's been undertaken is robust, and it also remains the case, and I would say that not wanting to repeat words, but I would say to members that the committee, whilst it did indeed debate that issue, obviously back in March, the debated issue of transport traffic generally, it ultimately didn't feel that it wanted to refuse the proposal on that basis. So there are no changes to circumstances in respect of the overall scale and scope of the development and the modelling that's taking place now, as opposed to where we were back in March.
Thank you very much. I just remind members, I mean, we all have our thoughts on this, and some of them, my thoughts have been far better and more eloquently expressed by others, but this is not an inquest on the March meeting. We have to focus on the points that we're being asked to consider, which in a nutshell is around the change to the affordable housing percentage and how we're going to deal with this clearly hugely important issue of the education provision. So with that in mind, could I ask Keith if he wishes to contribute?
Thank you again, Chairman. I'll try and restrict my comments then. Mr. Steptoe referred to neighbourhood planning policy EP3, but he did somewhat selectively refer to it, and missed out some chance of this. We didn't comment on the preschool provision, which I don't see was referred to in the rest of the notes, but I may have missed it. Because in reality, as another councillor said, you'll get some people arrive for secondary school children, you'll get some people arrive, infants and people will produce children that will require that level of education. And he did not also refer to, I'm interested in his comments in B, where schools should be available ahead of residential occupancy in any case, no later than the academic year in which 25% occupancy is anticipated, which is essentially saying that the school should be available pretty quickly. But I would just a little point that someone else touched upon about issues not previously raised. Somebody raised the issue of healthcare, I think. Maybe we're not supposed to consider this now. But another meeting that I've had in another forum shows that the clinical commissioning group for this area has no plans for any of the development in Bishopsthorpe North, nor has it any plans to recruit any doctors for that area. I thought I'd toss that in.
Thank you.
Yes, preschool places, of course, we haven't touched on it in discussion before, and no, I haven't either. I entirely understand. The provision that is made as part of the 106 agreement is that funding is also provided to accommodate the demands generated by the scheme for preschool services that the County Council, through its education role, delivers. Councillor Warnell there referred to EP4, which is indeed the further element of the policy. School provision should follow the guidance from Harts County Council in terms of paying for school places. Ultimately, we have a position here where, as I say, the authority that's responsible for the ensuring that education provision is made is satisfied with the approach. Not all glitches or potential issues may be resolved at this stage, but they feel, and in their advice to us, they feel that there is a sufficient and satisfactory strategy in place for what they see as an optimum solution. But if we can't achieve that, we can still achieve sufficient schooling for the development we have in front of us now. So. My view is that is reasonably following the guidance from the County Council, and therefore the policy is complied with. The policy then goes on to say about the school should be available, as we've heard, ahead of residential occupation where possible. There are very few circumstances, of course. Yes, we would love the ideal situation where we could provide all the infrastructure in advance of development, and I've said to members many times, that I cannot foresee a circumstance across East Harts or in many other places across the country where that we would reach that panacea. It is entirely appropriate for us to seek to ensure that we have the delivery programme in place for the delivery of the infrastructure, and that is what we have here. So yes, where possible would be ideal, and I say we can't meet that ideal, but we can meet what we feel is a satisfactory arrangement. So, Chairman, yes, I feel that EP4 is also addressed and in very large part satisfied, and we have satisfied both the preschool requirements also.
Thank you, members. Thank you.
Yes, sorry, Mr. Steptoe seems to be having some challenges from the floor. Well, I'd like to help him on this occasion. I'd like to refer to section 2.21, which says that the two schools planned in ASLs 1 to 4, both schools would include nursery provisions. So I think he's correct in saying that that is covered. I'd just like to pick up on the point, though, that Councillor Page mentioned. Does the provision of a school on this site, and excuse me if I should know this, entirely depend on the allotment site being purchased from Bishop Stortford Town Council, or is there a plan B?
Did I see another hand?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Brief point. I just wanted to say, isn't it maybe academic, that if I was at the meeting in March, I would have made great emphasis about the healthcare provision. I note that under the Section 106 contributions for ASR5, there's close to $500,000 for sports, and there's something like $171,000 for healthcare provision, contribution to the health centre. Equally within the report itself, again, I say it makes reference to the likely health centre. If you're going to increase the population of a town of 37,000 people by 16%, you must have some joined up thinking on issues like this. And if at the very least it can be taken on board in terms of future joined up thinking in relation to building large housing developments, there has to be integrated thinking much better than I've seen today in relation to healthcare provision. And I just wanted to make that point, certainly on behalf of the people in the room, because I would be embarrassed to be sitting in the audience tonight to not have some of these other issues at least mentioned, and instead of just focusing on the two issues that have been driven towards. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes, there was a couple of points there, Chairman, wasn't there, about does it depend on the allotment side? Does the delivery of education on this side depend on the allotment side? And the answer is no, it doesn't. This side provides its own one form entry school. So if the whole of those aspirations that the education, the County Council's education responsible authority has for an optimum solution, if the whole of that falls away because other parties take a view that they don't want to be involved in that, that does not prevent the provision of land that's sufficient for the delivery of one form of entry on the school entry at primary level on this site, and that accommodates the demand that's generated by this site. So the answer to that is a clear no, it does not depend on the allotment side. The healthcare issue, we again, I understand entirely the points being made and the funding that's secured as part of this development proposal. The services that are responsible for the development of healthcare do seek funding through new development schemes. In the recent past, have started to seek funding. This is an enlightenment, I think. I would probably say on behalf of those services. So for many years, have not done this, but now realise, of course, the additional burden on their services as a result of new development, and do seek funding that goes towards schemes that they're developing for future provision. On the basis of their standard, they have a standard approach that assesses clearly they have a lot of data on demand on GP services and hospital services, of course, per head of population over the years. And based on their understanding of all that, they do seek a sum per new home that's developed. The provision that's made here does not meet that in its entirety, and you'll see that across the service areas, we've said that there are some where funding is not met in its entirety, and we have sought to ensure that there's viability reassessment, of course, so that if any additional funding can be released, it can go towards those service areas. So Chairman, we are making provision. It may not be, again, the entirety of that provision, but we seek to put a further safeguard in place that should that ability be achieved in the future, further funding can be released.
Thank you, Kevin. Is there anything more from the floor? You can.
Well, if no other members have any comments, I guess it falls to me to make a proposal for refusal of this on the grounds of IMP 1 and EP local plan EP 3.
I'm going to ask Kevin for guidance on that because we have to be very, very clear. Do you have a second then?
Is there a second?
If I may, Chairman, I'll just turn to...
Just
to
898.
This room. EP, just turning to the education policy first.
Yeah.
And I want to be entirely clear. I'm quoting from the... So EP3. EP3. So, Chairman, new primary schools are to be built in the neighbourhood area in line with the growth in population, taking into account available capacity of existing schools serving the catchment area. Such schools, if delivered as one form entry schools, must be designed to ensure that they have the capability of expanding to at least two form entry at a later date.
Just a reminder of the two you did.
IMP1. So this is development schemes. As part of development schemes, developers will be required to make appropriate provision for affordable housing, open space and recreation facilities, education facilities, healthcare facilities, sustainable transport modes, highway improvements, nature conservation and landscape improvements, sustainable construction issues and other infrastructure improvements. The council will use planning conditions and or planning obligations to require developers to provide or to finance the cost of such provision, which will be fairly and reasonably related in scale and kind of development. Chairman, our advice to you would be that members have not, as far as I recall, have touched particularly on the affordable housing issue tonight. We've talked about that being the percentage has increased. So it is making provision for affordable housing, and it is making provision for all of those other elements. So I think it's down to do members feel that it is an acceptable provision. So you heard the list there: open space, recreation facilities, education facilities, healthcare, sustainable transport modes, highway improvements, nature conservation and landscape improvements, sustainable construction, other infrastructure improvements. I would be very cautious. In March of this year, you were concerned, as I say, in relation to affordable housing and primary education only. That's a much longer list. The proposals are no worse in relation to any of those other areas of infrastructure. So I would certainly invite members to be very cautious in relation to relying on that policy. Just it's a simple policy. It may be that members want to specifically highlight education seems to be the issue of that list, but I'll listen to what members want to say.
Just for what it's worth, I mean, clearly we are being asked to focus very clearly on social housing, affordable housing, and the educational elements. And that's really, I think, what we need to be very sure about. On the basis of that, do you have a second, please, for your proposal?
We've
looked
at our policy, Chairman.
I also refer to Naples Plan Policy EP3.
Ah, okay.
I wonder if, Chairman, if I could, just so as we look at the work lines, I wonder if I could invite through you, Chairman, the member may want to just the detail of those policies.
Well, in EP3, there's been plenty of reference to the feeling is that the school provision within the neighbourhood area of development vision taken into account the guidance of Hertfordshire County Council. I don't think anyone's actually said that that's been
properly, it's 100% in what everyone would agree with. And item B, this occupancy thing, I don't think that it's been addressed either. It's all sort of what is reasonable, it's not nailed down, and I just feel this has not been fully met.
If I may, Chairman, because I think, you know, we've talked about the same policy, so apologies if I was looking elsewhere. I hear entirely what members are saying around concerns remain in relation to the timing of the delivery. So the provision should follow the guidance from Hertfordshire County Council in terms of school planning places. I think we'd be very hard pressed to be able to demonstrate that we're not following the guidance. As I say, the county is the authority responsible for the education of pupils in the area, has not raised an objection to the scheme and has given us a range of advice in relation to pupil yield, the timing of that pupil yield, and has expressed, certainly has not expressed dissatisfaction with the proposals that are in place to deal with that. So I think we would be very hard pressed to say that guidance has not been acknowledged. So the other element of the policy about the places being available in advance of occupation and no later than the academic year when 25% occupancy is anticipated, Chairman, I'm not sure even the County Council's guidance goes into that sort of detail or requirement. What I would say to members is, yes, I think that on the face of it, as I say, I cannot say to members, I cannot guarantee that there would not be any pinch points or any potential for other than total alignment of infrastructure provision with development. What I would say to members is, I think we would be seen to be acting unreasonably in the basis of our position in relation to housing land supply, which I know is not one that finds a lot of favour with the whole range of interests around development sites, but then engages a requirement for the MPPF, and the MPPF, and you know the policy, the reference I'm going to make to that, is that unless the harmful impacts of development significantly and demonstrably outweigh the benefits, we should be seeking to support development. So in this respect, I think what we're saying is we have a remaining concern that the delivery may not be aligned quite as comfortably as we'd like it to be. We're not entirely hand in glove. We've got enough overall, but we're not satisfied we're entirely hand in glove, although we haven't articulated where that mismatch may be. Members may want to come back on that. But I think in relation to the position the MPPF sets out, I think we would be on a... It would be very difficult for us as an authority to provide a position that substantiates that, Chairman, if we're challenged. And indeed, we are being challenged, of course, in relation to the development scheme at this site already. My advice, Chairman, is I would be very cautious in relation to that proposal.
Thank you, Chairman, for allowing me to come back. This neighbourhood plan has been officially made. It's been officially made in consultation with East Hearts and other statutory consultees, including Hearts County Council. It's also been found by the inspector not to contravene anything to do with the MPPF. So how can it suddenly be disregarded? It concerns me.
Councillor Jones.
Thanks, Chairman. Could we just get clarity on, I made a note, that delivery of the one form entry school, September 2017, if that's correct. 329 homes, one assumes that's a 7-year build.
if it's, I think it's normally what, about 50 a year. If that's the case, in relation to EP3, for timings of the school, within 25% of the first occupancy. Am I right in saying that that does comply then to EP3 in the Silver Leaves plan?
What we need to factor into account, Chairman, is of course the ASR, the school delivery data quoted there was in relation to the one elementary school on ASR 1-4, and of course delivery will also be taking place on those sites. So, Chairman, I'm not sure if that's been factored into the calculation there. What we are saying is, and hopefully I'm clear in the message, what I'm saying is that there is a one form entry school to be delivered at ASR 1-4. There's a further one form entry school to be delivered at this site. One form entry, neither of those form the optimum solution, but if all else fails, then they are the form of education provision that can be secured. We have 2017 in relation to the one form entry school at the ASR 1-4 site, because of course we've progressed the development of that site, we've granted planning permission, and the county has taken further steps to progress the development of that site. Chairman, if members feel that the circumstances are such that we cannot rely on anything outside of this site, so this optimum solution we were talking of elsewhere, then of course we would seek that the county take steps to speed up delivery in relation to this site. That's the situation we're in. That's why we have got a definite date in relation to one form entry school, because the matters have moved ahead in relation to that site. In relation to that the maths and the calculation, of course, much depends, and this is why it's so difficult for the county to be able to align its resources in an efficient way. Much depends on how developers will seek to progress the development of their sites. All developers will tell us that they're very keen to make progress as early as they possibly can, and you know, we've no reason to disbelieve that, but there are a whole range of factors that affect their ability to achieve that. The County Council as a public authority, of course, I think would be hugely criticised if it pushed ahead very early with school delivery on the basis of developers saying, yes, of course, we're going to deliver. It takes what it feels to be the most pragmatic view, continual soundings about development coming forward, trying to finesse its delivery in relation to the land and resources it has available at all times. Colleagues at the county authority who deal with this day in, day out, I've no doubt they will seek to align as closely as they absolutely possibly can delivery on this side. But I just cannot give that guarantee to members that it will be on this date and it will be no later than 25% occupancy. That is the comfort I'm able to give to members. Chairman, there's that point about the policies of the neighbourhood plan and can they be disregarded? No, of course they cannot be disregarded. Chairman, this is very clear advice in relation to that. They must be given, taken into account and given weight. But as with all of the policies that you have to consider, they are one element. And you have to consider, are they the primary element which attracts most weight as such that guides your decision making? Chairman, our experience is that across the country, neighbourhood plan policies are clearly important, but national policy is still also very important. And that the weight to be given to the ability to deliver 5 years land supply is very significant indeed, Chairman. So I would be incorrect if I was advising you other than that national policy requirement does need to be given very substantial weight.
and members need to decide what weight they give to their other policy, other range of policies, including the neighbourhood plan.
Thank you very much. Mike.
Thank you, Chairman. Just to echo what Mr. Steptoe has said and picking up a point from Councillor Warnell, the neighbourhood plan under section 1113, under its limitations, does specifically say that it must not conflict with the MPPF.
Yes, thank you for that, reminding us of that. I think it's time to move this forward. Keith, you have your proposal. Do you still wish to pursue it?
Providing there's a seconder.
Would you invite a seconder? Councillor Page. We have a proposal on the table, duly seconded, that we refuse this application. Can we please take a show of hands on that?
Against what time?
Can we have some clarification?
Have some clarification if we, which one we're voting, because obviously the application itself is to grant. So we're going
against it. Yeah, and it's the points that you have already put before us.
So if we go against what Councillor Warner is saying, and the majority are against him, then the motion application, it passes.
The proposal falls and we vote on the application. Okay. There may be another proposal. Can we have a show of hands to indicate whether we accept that proposal? Those against? That proposal has fallen.
Could I take you now to consider the recommendation on page 9? This is a complex report. I'm absolutely salute all of you for the work you've put into this, especially those members of you who are comparatively new to this council, and moreover, those who are not at the various stages that we've looked at this before. There have been many, many meetings around this whole ASI 1-5 development, and it is a significantly complex series of applications. I suspect the most complex that we've considered for very, very many years. So I thank you all for the work that you've put into it. Officers feel comfortable recommending to us that the affordable housing, they've increased the percentage, they've affected the balance in a way which they feel is appropriate, without sacrificing any of the other elements of the 106. And they are comfortable, and they tell us, I think in the report at 8.3.2, that they are confident that notwithstanding the many issues that you quite rightly raised, and I'm sure we will be talking about again, they're confident that the education provision is going in the right direction. On that basis, could I ask you to consider the recommendation, which is to grant, outlined, as I said earlier in the paper on page 9, and continuing over to page 10. If you have no objection, I would go for en bloc. If you wish to do it individually, I'm happy so to do it. Jeff.
Chairman, yeah, if I could, in the recommendation one, in consultation with, could we include the ward members in that consultation? And that would also add in recommendation 4 as well. I don't see since you mentioned the ward members.
I think that's a very good point, and it was one I had considered, because they are specifically mentioned, well, Bishop Stortford members are specifically mentioned in 2.
Yeah.
So I think it's probably possibly 1, 2 and 4. Is that a possibility? Is that an impractical value?
If I may, Chairman, I think the concern is covered, because recommendation 2 is about the authority to make amendments to the proposals that are to be secured through the Section 106 agreement, and that does indeed require the chairman to be consulted, the portfolio, and the 2 members, Bishop Stortford members. So that's covered, and condition 4 seeks the same arrangement in relation to the conditions that are to be applied. So members are to be consulted around those two areas of which we're seeking delegated authority. 1 and 3 simply seek to set up the principle that we go ahead, if members resolve to support the proposals, we go ahead to formulate the Section 106 agreement in full detail and to impose the conditions that you have. There may be some further tweaks to those that we'd certainly consult members that those selected members on.
Yeah, okay, because in 1 it's set out in reference paper 8. So if you're agreed, I would like to take those on block. Any other comment? No? Can we have a show of hands, please, if you're agreed? Those against? Any abstentions? That is granted. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. We appreciate the time and effort you're putting coming this evening. And to all of you who have engaged with this process, it's vitally, vitally important that you do, and we really very, very much appreciate it. I'm not aware of any other urgent business, so on that basis, I'll close the meeting at 9 o'clock.